Now, to be perfectly honest with you, and that's what I want to be all the afternoon, this aeroplane, although it is a stork German aircraft, it was built in France about 1950 by the Moran Company and had a Jacobs 7-cylinder radial engine. And they're demonstrating just how slowly it can fly. About 60 miles an hour. Solid bruiser of an aeroplane, able to carry a big torpedo inside the fuselage. A big blown chorus this afternoon by Alan Walker. Navigator and a gunner. And then the second of the World War II aircraft. This is the Vought Corsair, the Bent Wing Bird as it was called. A naval fighter. This aeroplane, the Clown 400 Corsairs, which were flown by the Royal New Zealand Air Force.
Keeping and built cool in there.
Not by the Vought Company, but by Goodyear. And now, another fighter from World War II, this time one of the enemy, the Japanese Zero, the dreaded Zero fighter, which caused a diving down in a simulated torpedo attack. Alan Walker in the Big Avenger, the torpedo-carrying bomber, moving in quite fast at a top speed of 270 miles an hour. World War II, and nearly 10,000 of them were built for use by the United States Navy, by the Royal Navy, and seven other countries. Here he comes. With bomb doors. Oh, torpedo bay. Horsepower engine originally, and quite lightweight, which helped its maneuverability and high performance. It outflew and it outgunned the Allied aircraft. It weighed 1.5 tons empty, and when loaded with guns and ammunition and piloted fuel, just 2.5 tons, which was a good deal less than the weight of the Avenger. There we can see Yuffie, Frankfurt, rolling the aircraft, inverting Alan Walker, banks and twists to get away from the very heavy armament in this Japanese fighter. Two big 20mm cannon and two heavy machine guns. This replica was built for you for the film Tora, 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 which many of you, I'm sure, will have seen. But here they come, ladies.
Look at that, Nigel!
Zero. Zeros flew way back in March 1939, and about 350 were built for the Imperial Japanese Navy. One of its adversaries was this big, battling corsair, the bent-wing bird. Why were its wings bent? Well, by bending the wings down and away from the fuselage, putting the undercarriage at the bottom bit, as it were, in the knuckle, you produced a very short undercarriage which could be tucked up inside the airplane. Corsair in US Navy markings, being flown by Ralph Meehan, and its 2,000 horsepower Pratt & Whitney twin Wasp, 18 cylinders, turning a very large propeller, gave it a top speed of 420 miles an hour. And it could scramble up to 37,000 feet, so 7 miles high. And it too, quite heavily armed with 6 half-inch machine guns. But moving in again from your right, the Avenger, with Zero hot on its tail, and over the top, the Corsair coming in for the kill. You can imagine those 6 half-inch machine guns spitting fire and lead, trying to down the Zero. Strangely, when the first of the Corsairs was flown in March 1940, the US Navy rejected it. They thought it was too complex and too dangerous an aeroplane to fly on carriers, but they very soon changed their mind. It really was a tremendous aircraft. by the US Navy, and as we said, the Royal New Zealand Air Force, and the Royal Navy, operating off carriers through until the end of the Second World War. And as Alan Walker takes the Avenger around to our right, Lee Proudfoot in the Zero, coming back down the runway and banking up, showing us the wing shape, the Corsair behind. And there the Japanese, the meatball is that big red. The Corsair's got him. See a hit there on the Zero. And I wonder what he's going to do. Is he going to try and land it, or is he going to bail out?
He's not going to bail out, is he?
Everybody's voting for a bailout, but not this afternoon, I think.
Oh my God.
Way to our right, the Avenger. Rolling out down the runway while the smoke-streaming Zero curlits to fight another day with his highly manoeuvrable aeroplane. But now, diving down in an attack on the airfield, the Corsair. With Rolf Biehm really pouring on the cull there in this aircraft, building up the timing. Edge of the wing. The aircraft turning off the runway. About one third of its length. The aircraft will gain height and very shortly we shall see them step out from this aircraft to open their display. But our attention now to the front, where the Supermarine Spitfire 9 of the old Flying Machine Company being flown for us today by John Hart, now retired from his last career as a test pilot in British Aerospace, flying the Harrier jet. And down the runway goes the implacable enemy of the unmistakable elliptical wing of the incomparable Spitfire, described as the most beautiful fighter ever. I don't think anyone of us here will argue with that. This airplane, owned by the old Flying Machine Company, first flew in August 1943, 48 years ago. Here's John Farley. Come on in. 5,000. Spitfire, the Mark 9, were built, and it was the most widely used. In the hands of Greyhound. Leader of the Red Arrows and a very experienced Royal Air Force pilot. Here we have a father and son team flying for us today. Son Mark, we've already seen in the young one. Father, it'll be met with 109. And the almost unbelievable total of 33,000 Messerschmitt 109s were built by the German aircraft engines, and it wasn't until after the war Rolls-Royce Merlin became available for them. This aeroplane carries the markings of number 26, Jagd Squadra, which operated over the channel and flying from air bases in France and Holland and also over Malta. And this distinctive yellow nose on the Messerschmitt 109. Something to be respected in the sky. There the black and white spinner catching the eye, showing the rapidly spinning propeller. But now moving in again from our left, the Spitfire Mark 9. The Spitfire 9, first went into service in July 1942 in number 64. Feeling on the scene again. Ray Hanna following him round. Spitfire. Tons, just a little bit heavier than the Messerschmitt. Protruding from the leading edge of the Spitfire's wing. As I said, the with the orange and black marking of the Belgian Air Force. The renowned Rolls-Royce Merlin, and he enclosed it in such a slender fuselage.
I can see him.
Where? Mom, is that a red arrow up there?
Now we wait for the Russian entrant.
We don't have a picture of that one yet.
The Yak 11. Yak 11 with a two-seat trainer, but rather confusingly, it's its paint scheme is that of a La 7. This afternoon by with us here
Nigel,
in Alcanbury. The
Nigel.
Spitfire 5B.
Yeah, that one, look on there. Nigel, that one's
and he has some 800 or 900 hours display flying in Spitfires and Hurricanes on the flight. But once again, this elliptical wing, but this was an earlier mark of Spitfire. About 18 months younger than the Spitfire 9, which we saw earlier, but the same unmistakable shape.
I don't want to miss it now.
Pretty unmistakable crackle of that splendid Rolls-Royce Merlin engine, some 1,200 horsepower. Known as the last of the many, the last of 14,000 Hurricanes built. Pulling round in a very tight
turn.
There we can see quite a different wing shape from that of the Spitfire. Very functional. Thicker wing, able to... And once again, the Hawker Hurricane. Markings, and I find that this is Fox the commentator day because the Battle of Britain flight said they were going to bring the last one, the last of the Hurricanes, but this looks as though it is in fact serial LF363 and quite a film star in its own right, having appeared in Reach for the Sky, Angels 1-5 and the Battle of Britain film. And the markings it carried are those of Flight Lieutenant Nicholson, the only pilot of RAF Fighter Command to be awarded a Victoria Cross during World War II, for Hurricanes still flying today. Here in the hand, the serving Royal Air Force pilot. There are only two airworthy Lancasters still flying, one in Canada and the one flew the Lancaster. 156,000 individual sorties were made with Lancasters. Here, with undercarriage down and the crew all watching us, I'm sure. Lancaster with the Hurricane, the Humpty Back one, and the Spitfire on the Battle of Britain Memorial Flight. Mustangs were built, but getting airborne, a shape we learned to know and love very well, the Boeing Flying Fortress, the B-17. Now the Mustangs coming round from our right. The tremendous armament which it carried for self-protection. 13 half-inch guns, two in its chin, one in its nose, one on top of the fuselage, two on each side of the fuselage, a couple in the ventral ball turret, and two more in the tail. Sally B. Boeing B-17 Flying Fortress. Into the arena. Back onto the center line. From the center of the airfield. Sally B, bomb bay doors open. Quite a small bomb bay for such a big airplane. It's to carry 4,000 pound bombs. But over a very great distance, as I say, nearly 2,000 miles. almost down to Rome and back. And there, the undercarriage down, Bombay doors open. Sally B, a tight turn, round almost inside the airfield boundary. Carriage and Bombay doors dangling. Sally B to B17, flying quarter. '50s and '60s era opens, but not before a final appearance of the two Mustangs. Once again, the Mustangs roar in. In a simulated ground, going up in big barrel row. Imagine the barrel lying on the side. Yet again. The P-51 needs Mustangs in the Royal Air Force. Low and fast down the runway here. Smoking a little as the front comes on. And then Jaguars were very active in the Gulf Theatre where they were used carrying missiles or tanks on tops of the wings as well as underneath, and the aircraft able to carry a very heavy load, some 10,000 pounds of, I'm sorry, 4.5 tons of weapons. Tank at about 130 miles an hour. Nose cocked up. Slow the aircraft. Was a single seater, but the basic design was unchanged since about. A modest amount of thrust, some 2 tons or less. Giving the aeroplane a top speed of some 600 miles an hour. Very sleek looking aircraft. Aircraft going up in a big wing over. Making a splendid picture of the silver finish, lifting in the sunshine against the low of Rebecca Toon and Katie Hodkinson.
I can't reach it. Yeah, don't take one of that one. Once it comes round.
Running down the runway with the effortless ease which it showed in the air. The yellow and Comet, the world's first four-jet airline reconnaissance aeroplane, able to carry torpedoes, depth charges, with a host of radar equipment. Over. Is on the outside of the turn.
Upside down.
speed of about 650 miles an hour and able to climb 5 miles high in 5 or 6 minutes. Got a Rolls Royce Adour engine, the same as in the Jaguar. Search and rescue system. The aircraft being flown by Flight Lieutenant Merv Counter and Warrant Officer Dave Allen. Knowledge of what's going on the other side of the hill is the basis of all good Army and Air Force operations. Here we see taxiing down. Thank you.
my demonstrating the climbing ability of the F-15.
Flight Lieutenant Guy Riley. In the front seat is pilot with Flight Lieutenant Steve Kinnaird, who is the display navigator.
Don't wander off where we were though. Hey.
Clear of any enemy forces and the recovery.
Turning around,
not only he, but the
They've got it to our folks, right, boy.
Sergeant Paul Hunt.